As we've seen, some manufacturers make unique products such as aircraft or made-to-order furniture, and they use a job order cost system. Other manufacturers mass produce large numbers of similar or identical items, such as soft drinks or boxes of cereal. For mass production, you will see that process costing is the costing system that is used to assign cost to inventory. So once again, there are two basic costing systems, job order cost system and process cost system. As a reminder, in a job order system, we will assign direct material used, direct labor, and overhead applied, that is our product costs, to each job or a batch of units that are alike. We'll use this if we customize orders or produce many highly differentiated products. In process cost system, you will see that we will assign direct material used, direct labor, and overhead applied to each department or process. We'll use this if we have continuous production of a homogeneous product. So we have very similar products that we produce over and over, and it's hard to distinguish one unit from the other. In these cases, it is difficult to identify exactly what end to producing one unit. So compare that to manufacturing a house or an aircraft. You know exactly what went into that unit. But if you think about manufacturing cans of soup, you don't really know how many peas goes into one can of vegetable soup. You know how many peas go into a batch of cans of soup. So some examples of companies that would use a process cost system would be oil refineries, a flour mill, office supplies, electronics. There are many different companies that would use a process cost system. You will consider the information needs and the cost benefit when you decide which one to use. So, which costing system is more expensive to use from a record keeping standpoint? If you said job order costing, you would be right. Just note that there is operations costing, which is a hybrid system. You will do this if you have products that have some common characteristics and some unique characteristics. We will not really cover that in this course, but I would like you to be aware that there is this thing called operations costing. All right, similarities between job order and process costing. They're very similar in the way production costs are recorded on the books. That is, materials, labor, and overhead are assigned in a very similar fashion. If you'll recall, we said that you debit work in process inventory when direct material is used, direct labor is recorded, or overhead is applied. These costs will get transferred to finished goods inventory when the goods are completed, and cost of goods sold when the inventory is sold. Well, that will continue to hold true in process costing. The differences. What is really different is how we assign cost to individual units of inventory. In a process costing system, materials, labor, and overhead are added in multiple departments. They just move from one process to the other. And these costs must be recorded as work in process inventory in each of these departments. So Campbell's Soup might have a washing department, a cutting department, a cooking department, a canning department, a labeling department. And the costs will flow in sequence from one department to another. In other words, they accumulate as you move from one department to another. And you are going to see that we do have a separate work in process account for each manufacturing department. So Campbell's Soup Company would have a work in process inventory dash cutting, a work in process inventory dash canning, etc. All right, let's look at how we cost inventory in a process costing environment. You will need to compute a cost per unit. This is so that you can make management decisions and prepare your financial statements. You will need to take the cost of any one time period and assign it to the units completed and the cost of the ending work in process, because at any time you may have some partially completed inventory and some completed inventory. Now, a cost per unit, if you'll recall, you will add up the production cost, materials used, direct labor, and overhead applied, and divide by the units produced. The problem is the denominator. At any given point in time, some units are completed and some are partially completed. So for Campbell's Soup Company, if they manufacture 5,000 cans of soup and 4,000 are finished and 1,000 are halfway finished, what is your denominator to divide by? The accounting solution is we will translate finished units into what we call equivalent units. Then we'll calculate a cost per equivalent unit to value our inventories. Now, equivalent units are a measure of the work done during the period expressed in fully completed units. This allows the accountant to calculate the cost per unit when some units are partially completed. An example of equivalent units is if you had 100 units, 30% complete, the computation would be 100 times 0.3, or 30 equivalent units. Now, the idea here is that it would cost the same to produce 100 units that were 30% complete as it would to make 30 completed units. Now, this is just an accounting assumption, and it's our way of dealing with partially completed inventory. Most companies will add materials at specified points. Often, it has to be added at the very beginning of the process. Again, thinking about Campbell's Soup Company, they would need to add the vegetables at the beginning and then process with labor and overhead throughout the process. Now, you may need to have a separate calculation then for direct material, direct labor, and overhead for your equivalent units. So when we go to work a problem, you do want to identify how many columns you need. And you may need up to three. You'll need one, two, or three for materials, labor, and overhead. We'll look at how you determine that when we work our example. We will be preparing a cost of production report. This replaces the job cost sheet, so it's an internal document for management decisions. It will provide information about the costs incurred and the inventory produced, and it will be used for evaluating productivity, cost control, setting prices, etc. Now, the summary of key differences you see there in your notes, you will want to review this after you've worked some problems. It really just summarizes the things we just talked about, so be sure to reference that in your notes when you go back to study. Now, there are two methods for calculating cost per equivalent unit. There's the weighted average method, which averages all costs incurred over all work done. The FIFO method keeps two separate layers, a beginning layer and a current layer. While I think it's useful to know that there is a FIFO method, this method is not covered in the course. So you're responsible for the weighted average method. You also need to know what transferred in costs are. These are costs that were incurred in a previous process and brought into a later process. In other words, they're transferred from the cutting department to the canning department. They do require a separate calculation. We are not going to cover the calculations for transferred in costs in this course, given that it's an introductory course. But you do need to know what transferred in costs are. Now we'll look at preparing a production cost report using the weighted average method. There are six steps to do this. First, you want to account for the physical flow of products. This will simply show the units to be accounted for. And the formula you will use is beginning work in process units plus units started equal ending work in process units plus units completed. This will summarize for management the inventory that was worked on. It's a very logical process. The units you began with plus what you started are either finished or they're not. The second step is to accumulate your costs. Third, you'll calculate equivalent units. Fourth, you'll calculate cost per equivalent unit. Fifth, you'll value your inventories. And then sixth, you will provide a cost reconciliation. This simply shows management the cost that flowed through work in process during the period. The formula is beginning cost plus current cost equal cost of ending work in process plus units completed, or the cost of those units completed. Next up, we'll work an example, so tune back in soon.